about last time.
Oh no, wait.
No, don't tell.
Wait. When he dropped the mic, can I pick it up?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Last night we went to a concert, Maverick City. They showed out. The greatest day he showed out.
Oh yeah.
And let me tell you something. Saturday I was in my feelings. I ain't gonna lie to you. I was in my feelings because what I thought should happen didn't happen.
Okay.
And so I was thinking, God, yeah, I am. I think I'm doing your will. I think I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. I speak your word. I say what you want me to say. I tell people what you want me to tell people. And I'm doing what I think I'm supposed to be doing. But yet, it's not happening for me, God. What's wrong, God? What's wrong with this picture, God? And so I'm in the middle of worship, and I'm like, yeah, I'm just gonna forget about that. I don't care, you know. And all of a sudden, in the middle of the concert, my head started hurting. I'm like, oh, God, I can't. My voice still praising the way it was praising. And so I'm watching. I'm looking at all these young people. They're praising God, lifting their hands up. You got people on the stage, young people, just. Twins and the teens, they praising God like, I don't know what. And I'm like, hey, God, yes. I'm going to be real with you here.
Yeah,
all right. God, I thank you. I praise you for what you're doing for them. I thank you, God, both for them. You say the little prayer, you know, you mean it, but it's not in you. And so I'm sitting there. And so we in Columbia, and I'm like, oh, yeah, I see Travis Ring right there. He getting ready to come up on stage. I see. And then all of a sudden, Naomi Ray said, we got somebody else here. I'm thinking, who else is down there? So I look down there, and I look at me, and my eyes met, and I'm like, and my tears just started falling. Because it was the one person who I had said, God, I want to see this person live. I want to see him. He's only come to South Carolina one time, and he's 5 minutes away from my house. But it was Mama's pastoral anniversary that day, so I didn't get to go see her. So then they said, welcome up to the stage, Israel Howell.
Yes.
Y'all,
yes.
I started crying. It wasn't because, oh, I was so glad. No, it's because the word said he writes ministers to me. So I don't know if you notice or not, but every Sunday that I'm playing music, you hear at least one Israel song. That's how much he means to me and what he does mean. And I'm thinking, I'm sitting there, and God's like, I hadn't forgot about you.
Jesus.
The whole time God's saying, I hadn't forgot about you. So in the midst of me saying, God, why are you letting all this stuff happen? Why are you letting me speak to these people? But yet you forgetting about me. He's saying, I hadn't forgot about you. Somebody that had only been in South Carolina one time before, came all the way from California. He may not have known, but God was using him at that moment for me. So what I want to say to you is this. God hadn't forgotten about you. In the midst of what you're going through, in the midst of what you're praying, in the midst of everything that's happening to you, God says, I hadn't forgotten about you. I don't deserve it right now, God. I'm actually praying to you, God. I'm pouring out my heart to you. And God said, but I haven't forgot about you. It may look that way. You can't see. You can't see what's in front of you because of everything that you're going through. See, I can see Travis Green over there. I can see everybody else that was on the stage. I can see all of this stuff. But I can't see what God has for me because I was looking at what I was going through. But the whole time, You can just wait 1 second. See, even before. See, Naomi was about to bring him on stage, and then Chandler Moore says, "Hold on, wait, don't bring him up yet." And so even then, I gotta wait even longer, God. I gotta wait even longer. I done been through all this stuff, and then I gotta wait more. I gotta go through another hurdle. Yet one more thing to go through. And God is here, but it's right there if you can just wait. It's right there if you can just be patient. See, it's at the door. We get to the door, and then we say, "That's too long," and we walk away. And God is here. All you gotta do is take the energy to reach out and open, touch the door. Some of us are touching the door right now, and God is here to just twist the knob and say, "You ain't even got to pull the door open for the blessing to come pushing through." We're so busy looking at what's going on. We're so busy. But when we're too busy, God, how could you allow this to happen to me? God, I thought that I was, you said I was favored, God. How could you allow this? And God is saying, "If you just wait a minute." And I'll be honest with you.
Oh, yeah.
He's not just saying, "Wait a minute." He's saying, "Shut up and wait a minute." Because so many of us are too busy talking. We're too busy saying what we want to say, saying what we think needs to be said. Then you take too much time. If you're not careful, your blessing will walk away from the door. But in all of that, I just hear the Lord saying, just remind the people, "I hadn't forgot about you. In all that you're going through, I hadn't forgot about you. In everything that you see, I hadn't forgot about you. You're going through this for a reason. Not everything you go through is for you. Not everything, that every trial that you're in the midst of is for you. Not every test is for you. Sometimes you have been walking in the will of the Lord to the point that other people are too busy watching you. And your life is no longer your life, but it's your ministry. And people are watching your ministry. And they're trying to see how you're going to respond and how you're going to react. And it comes to a point that sometimes how you respond and how you react is how they take the gospel. And how they take God. And how they see Jesus. After I got through crying last night, I got back looking at all the people. And I was saying, "God, all these young people. There were people who were homosexuals there, different cultural denominations, different races. But guess what? It was the Spirit of God that called them. And that's who they were worshiping." Sometimes we can get caught up in labels. And we can get caught up in different people's sins. That we forget that the whole reason why we're here, the whole reason why we serve God, the whole reason why we worship Him. If He delivered us, He can deliver them too. And we have to keep in mind and we have to remember, we're not all the way delivered ourselves. Quit pointing fingers and looking at folks and saying, "Well, look at them, look at them, look at yourself." God still has some work to do on us too. I go to church every Sunday morning. Yeah, and that's the reason why demons are in the church also. Sometimes we have to back up and say, "God, God, it's me. It's me. The whole reason why you haven't done what you needed to do is because of me. I'm fighting myself. The biggest battle is not out there. It's right here." Sometimes, and I'm going to stop, but sometimes in the morning, the biggest fight that I fight all day long is right before I get out of bed. And then it's not even my wife. It's what's going on up in here. And that's what will determine my day. How will I fight this battle up in here? Would I blame everybody else? Or would I stop and say, hold on, devil. You're not going to have this. You can't win this one. Because I got to remember that no matter what I go through, God has forgotten me. I won't drop it. I'll just hand it to you.
Yeah. make your mistake.
Yes.
You're not babies no more.
That's right.
God has invested too much.
Yeah, I'm good.
God has invested too much into you for it to go to waste. And not think you won't hold to account.
That's right.
Even these children, even as they're listening to our voices every Sunday, every Wednesday, when they're listening, y'all, they being held accountable too. We have to be examples. We have to be models. Because they gonna do what? And I can say that because my students model me. Because they know when I take my mask and I have that shield on, if I cock my head one certain way, oh, now get quiet.
So, she mentioned one thing that about the young people modeling what older people are doing, especially in the church. The young people last night were hungry for God. I'm not just saying that they, oh, we going to a concert or we going to something. They were hungry for God. These young people were, they people that the church have pushed away.
Right.
People who those who say that they know God, they were the children who we just want to worship the God that we're reading about in the Bible. We want to worship the God that who's moving in our lives. They didn't have on suits. They didn't have on anything. They just wanted to worship God. And the way that they worship God, I'm gonna tell you something. I've been to a lot of concerts, but it's only in the concerts where God is using young people through hip-hop and rap that I've seen the closest worship with God. It's in those concerts where they're being brought that the anointing has been so high because nobody had a label on them. Sometimes when we are in church, we forget about the young people, and you ought to know better. But if we haven't taught them,
right.
If we haven't taught them, this is the reason why we're doing this. This is the reason why don't talk in church. Don't preach that. They haven't been taught not to quench the Holy Spirit.
Right.
They haven't been taught that the Holy Spirit is something so sensitive that you have to reverence. Sometimes we take it for granted what we already know, and we're not sharing that wisdom. And that's what God is calling us to do, share the wisdom. Pass the wisdom down from one generation to the next. Let them know that this is what the Holy Spirit looks like. This is the difference between someone who's praising God and someone who's just trying to get attention.
Right.
Because guess what? These young people, I was sharing with Bishop a couple of weeks ago. You can't just say something and not explain it. Because this is a generation who, the first thing that they hear that they don't explain, they go Google. And we would much rather them hear it from the gospel than from what Google has to say. Because there's so much out there. And if they aren't taught that this is what the Word of God is, and this is what the Word of God means, then they're going to accept whatever they hear. We have to take time, because it's not that, oh, these children these days. No, what have you taught these children these days? Have you sat down with them and told them, this is what we believe, this is why we believe? God is raising up an army, yes, but guess what? He needs the old generals to teach the soldiers how to do it. Don't get so caught up in the army and what you're doing, you're forgetting what your first commandment is, which is to build kingdom. God is moving.
Yes, he is.
He's moving. I don't know why God is going this direction today. But he's doing it for a reason. Like Sheila said, God is going to hold each and every one of us accountable.
Yeah.
It's not just the older ones, it's the younger ones too. If we want the gospel to continue and to go reach out into the earth, we got to teach. We got to let them know. And I thank God for it.
What worship really is. A lot of times when I get up here and sing, I feel like I get lost because I'm not singing for somebody to tell me I did good or for me to get any type of praise. I'm singing because that's how I directly communicate with God. Which is a lot of times why I don't volunteer to sing, because I feel like you're impeding on my time with God, because that's how I communicate with him. I know if I sing it to him, it's like it calls his ear. And it was, I think we were riding in the car and she would ask us what was our favorite part. And I feel like it was just being in a room where everybody understood what we were there to do. And we were there to worship. And just standing up and being in your own place and your own time. And it was like everybody was in their own rooms and having their own conversation with God. And everybody was getting what they needed. And I feel like that's what we need to do more. We need to stand up and give God our full attention and just like knock on his door. I feel like a lot of times we ask God for stuff, but are we like making sure that he's here? We have to get his attention. We have to, you know, call on him. If we're not spending that personal time with him, then maybe he's going to hear us. But if we're spending that time with him, he's going to be at a rush to get, you know, what we need done. So that's something that I've just been really working on personally, just spending time with God. And talking to him. And it doesn't have to be, I feel like we hear people pray and we think that, oh, I have to pray like that or I have to sound like that. But it can be however. Sometimes I talk to God and I'm like, listen now, you got one time, okay? But that's our relationship. And because I have a personal relationship with him, I can talk to him like that. I know how to go to him. I know how, he knows me and he knows how I communicate. And sometimes when I'm overwhelmed, I can't give him a Baptist prayer or a whatever prayer. I just have to say what I have to say and be like, okay, now what you gonna do with this? And so, yeah, and then here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy. Altogether wonderful to me, and I'll never know how much it costs to see my sins upon that cross. I'll never know how much it to see my sins upon that cross. One more thing. So I feel like a lot of times y'all say, like, oh, I don't know if you say this, but in my head, I'm like, well, I keep singing the same songs. But I'm singing, I always sing, open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Because I've been asking God for clarity. So I'm not singing that song because, oh, I have it down packed and I know where the runs are, but it's because I'm continuously asking God to open the eyes. I want to hear you. I want to see you. I want to know you. And so I continue to sing that song so he continues to give me that. So he continues to let me see him. So he can continue to let me hear him. So open the eyes of our hearts, Lord. Open the eyes of our hearts. We want to see. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you high and lifted up.
Hallelujah.
Shining in the light of your glory.
I there. But let me give you what God gave me. And it's not going to be long. Not long at all. A lot of you have gone through Matthew chapter 4. There was Jesus led up of the temple. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. That's what a lot of you've been. You've been led up and you've been tempted. You wanted to throw in the towel. But listen, and when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, some of you have been fasting for the answer. Hallelujah. And he was afterward a hungry. Was he hungry for men? No. He was hungry for God. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if, and a lot of God people are getting a lot of ifs. Hey, I don't know the whole son. If I had to do what they told me to do, I'd be all right. If I can do it, this by myself, I can be who I want to be. And the devil said to him, if you be the Son of God, cast yourself down. For the Bible reads that he will not let your foot, he won't let you stomp your foot or your toe. And a lot of you have went that way and you stumped your toe. But God took you up yet again. And all that I've heard this morning is saying, I have been tempted and tried. And after being tempted and tried, I got in a place where worship and adoration and acknowledgement to God. Hallelujah. I have. That's my co-pilot. That's all right. I have been in a place. You said to yourself, I've been in a place, and I don't know how I'm going to survive. But God has taken you up. And when you get to the place you don't know what to do, don't do nothing. Stand still and see the salvation of God. I know young folks, they ready to worship. And when she was, and the rest of them would tell me about this concert, and she said, Mom, some people had tattoos all over their face. Some people had this and that. It's not a skin problem that God is dealing with. It's a spiritual problem. We're so busy dealing with skin problems that we're not dealing with the spiritual problem. So when young folk get together and say to themselves, it's more to God than I'm getting out of it. And those of us that are matriarchs and mentors, we need to go ahead and do what God tells us to do. And trust God with these young folks. And give them something to do in the house of faith. Because that's what mama done made us usher. They made us do this. We don't make our children do anything they don't want to do. So now, I've heard the testimony of these young folks and the minister and Pastor John. God is doing something. And I don't want to miss him while he's doing something. Jesus was tempted with everything that we're tempted with. And you say, but God, you ain't never been in no hard place like this, really? The apostles were tempted with something. And one day I was so busy telling God how I was going through, and he said to me, have you suffered to blood? Have you suffered to blood? Have they stoned you? All you gotta offer God is they looked at me wrong. They talked about me. But you didn't suffer to blood? Some of these young folks have suffered some things. And they were trying to get out of it. You know, the tattoo meant that I'm a loving person. The tattoo meant that I need help. Now listen, we don't he ascended. And don't be offended when he sent it to somebody that you think he ought not to. The Sadducees and Pharisees thought he shouldn't have sent it from Jesus. Because Jesus was not a popular person. You're not either. Trust God. You know, I've done things wrong. You've done things wrong. We've done things wrong. And God led us to the wilderness. You've been led through the wilderness. And while you was going through the wilderness, you did get hungry. You were tempted above some things, but you held yourself together. And not God won't. And with the Bible says, after Jesus was tempted of the devil, the Lord sent the angels to minister to him. And when Jesus came off that mountain, when Jesus came off the mountain, there was a man standing at the bottom of the mountain. And Jesus came down from the mountain, and when he put his feet on the ground, the man said, I want to be healed. If you want to, you can heal me. And you know what Jesus said? I want to. So some of you are saying now, if you want to, Lord, you can take this away. Jesus wants to. But you've got to be standing at the foot of the cross. When you stand at the foot of the cross, God will move for you. You're not going to always have happy days. You ain't going to always laugh. But you know what? Every now and again, you need to water yourself with your own tears. You're coming through a rough time. It's not easy. But God will not. Trey said last week, he said he would, when they say he won't put no more on you than you can bear. Right. But I tell you a truth. Sometimes I think I can't bear. But yet I live to see another day. The sun will shine tomorrow, Annie. It will shine. And it's up to you whether you let it shine on you or not. There's so much going on. Listen, when you feel like you going through so hard you can't survive, go talk to somebody who is going through something. Many times I call a person and I'm going to pour out my complaint and tell them what I'm going through. And I said, how you doing now? I'm doing fine. You know, my husband did this, my children did this. And they begin to tell me and pour out their complaints to my ear. And then when they get through, they'll say, what you called me for? Nothing. Because that little mess that I was calling you about is not even worth mentioning because of what you're going through. Listen to somebody else when you think you're going through something hard.
That's right.
Listen to them. And when you listen to them, I put my stuff in my pocket, Pastor, and I don't pull it out. I tell you, I've been listening to people who are going through something so now that I get shame on my own self. But when Jesus was going through the wilderness, the Lord was with him. Even when he offered him, you know what, y'all? People are offering you money. They're offering you friendship. They're offering you whatever you think you need. But only when they offer you Jesus that you can survive this war. It is a war going on.
Yeah.
It may not get better. Buy you some water and some candy. I ain't playing this time. Last time I said that, everybody thought I don't play. Don't play. Somebody say, there's a storm out in the ocean.
Come on now.
And it's moving. Yes, this way.
Right.
And if your soul is not anchored, you're surely drift away. And I'm telling you now, get your anchor in Jesus.
Yeah.
Because if you look at the way that things are going right now, it's going to take a Jesus. intelligence. I'm gonna stay with Jesus. Because if he so clothed the lily of the valley, if he feed the birds in the air, he will feed you. He will give you your daily bread. He will be your Our Father, which art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Your will be done, not mine, God, because I done tried it my way. I got me houses, I got me cars, I got me men, I got me women. That's what Solomon said. But none of them could do me like Jesus. You gonna go through a valley? I don't care how saved you are. Let me tell you this, when you come to Jesus, Satan is a peeping Tom. He's a stalker. He's an abuser. But when you come to Jesus, and you're covered under the blood, he can't see what he wants to see, and he can't do what he wants to do. So the Lord is telling us today, get our house in order. Somebody said, well, God will take care of me. He will. He's going to give you wisdom and knowledge. I'll go to Walmart, CVS, any kind of store to get you some water. Because the devil ain't playing. He's an abuser. And he will kill you. So trust what these young women and men said this morning. You know what? It don't bother me if I don't get to preach. Because whatever God needs to say, he already done said. Well, you say, well, the preacher didn't preach. You got three preachers done preached, you know, this morning. Well, we didn't have no song. Yes, you did. You have a song right there. Ain't heard nobody pray. You wasn't here when they prayed. We did a round circle prayer. We was coming even to the point Sheba, Tanil, and Alex, the Lord had me praying for y'all on the way to church. Because the enemy don't want to see you in. Young people die too. They die. The devil fight young folk. And he will steal, kill, and destroy them. So when we leave this place, let us trust our Jesus, the one who thought it not robbery to come down from 40 and two generations to save a wretch like us. And guess what? He's still making intercession for us. Holy Spirit, I love him. I have used him more in the last year than I've ever talked to him. And guess what, Tanya? When I was moving that big old dresser, Mama got a big old Roy Hill dresser. It was in her room. And I moved it from her room to my room. And I looked at it and I said, Holy Spirit, I need a couple of angels to help me carry this dresser from my room, from Mama room to my room. And so I was looking at it and I said, show me how to hold it. Show me how to do it. And I took all the drawers out of it, and it was still heavy. And I said, I tell you what we're going to do. I said, angels, I'm going to guide it, but y'all push it. Mm-hmm. See, use the tools that God gave. And I said, I'm about to tilt it. And listen, when I was rolling it in my room, we got easier and easier. I said, look at us. And we put that long dresser. And one, the big tall one that's got the post on it, the dresses, we put it in my room. And guess what? They did most of the work. Because I trust God.
Yeah.
Start asking God to send you angels to do battle. Remember when Peter and them was trying to tell Jesus, and when they was trying to tell Paul, and Jesus said, if I could call down a garrison of angels right now to destroy my enemy. But I just wanted a few good angels to come down and help me move furniture. And they did. The testimony that we got from Pastor Galvin concerning his whole house. What was the man's name that was trying to get up in the sycamore tree? Anybody know him?
Zacchaeus
was trying to get up in the sycamore tree to see Jesus. Parents, are you trying to get up in the sycamore tree so that your whole house can be saved? We got to get somewhere, y'all. As them know that hell is hot and death is real. And one more thing, and I know I'm often rambling, but I'm gonna tell you this. Hell is making room for people. You know how I know? Look at the volcanoes. When they spill over, they making room in hell. When they spill over, you think hell gonna be too full for you? Keep on living a righteous life. And watch what happens. It's not gonna be too full. And heaven won't be too full for you. Jesus is waiting, and he's calling for you to come home. Come back in the fold. God is so good.